Hello. Welcome to Space Club.
Hello.
Yes. You don't say hello yet. I got to introduce you first.
What? Oh, okay.
Hello, everyone. Happy 2 months until Christmas on this October 25th, 2021. Welcome, of course, to Space Club. We're a monthly space exploration live stream. We're three former university colleagues who are now spread about the world. Working in the space sector, but each month we get together to talk about what's been going on in space. So we're happy to take questions if you're in the live chat or you want to join a future one if you're watching this in the archives. And if you do want to watch old ones to see what happened in the past, you can check out Tanya's YouTube channel. So my name's Danny Bednar. I'm a part-time assistant professor in the Department of Geography and Environment at Western University in London, Ontario, Canada. Where I teach about the geography of space exploration. I am also on season 9 of my RuPaul's Drag Race rewatch campaign. Joining me, as usual, is the president of the Mercadian Map Projections Are Overrated fan club, Dr. Professor Gentleman Phil Stooke, Esquire, Professor Emeritus at Western University, and, of course,
hello.
yeah, you can say hello now.
Oh, thank you.
And of course, our resident Martian expert, Tanya of Mars, president of the I'm Emotionally Attached to Multiple Robots, but that's okay because I work in the space sector, fan club, Dr. Tanya Harrison, Martian science expert. Thank you for joining us, Tanya.
Thanks. That is very accurate.
That is very accurate. So as usual, we get things started pretty quickly here with this day-ish in space-ish, and that is because not always are these things exactly on this day. This is a case of that, and they're also not always in space, but the two I'm talking about this month are actually in space. The first one I want to talk about is the launch 14 years ago of China's Chang'e 1 spacecraft. So this was China's first mission beyond the Earth, its first endeavor into planetary science, space exploration. And this spacecraft, which we'll ask Phil a little bit more about, but it did produce a full high-resolution lunar map. It tested technologies for future moon landings by China, which have now since passed. Of course, not with humans, but robotically. And then eventually was crashed into the moon, as most of these things tend to be these days. Phil, what were you doing on Wednesday, October 24th, 2007?
Oh, I can't remember that now. I can barely remember yesterday. But, well, I guess that what I was doing was avidly following along everything that Chang'e 1 was doing. Although it's not easy following, you know, keeping up to date with these Chinese missions. So the most you can hope for is a little bit of news one day and then a little bit of news a month later and that sort of thing, and you gradually piece it all together. But you're right, Chang'e 1 did make a global map at about 100 meter resolution and did a lot of other things as well, like microwave mapping of the lunar surface. Microwave sort of radiation from the surface rather than using radar or something like that. They got quite a few good data sets, topography, all sorts of things. Apart from that microwave mapping, which they used to study the regolith, everything else had really been done before. But the point is, it hadn't been done by China. And so they were learning the technology, they were developing the instruments, they were getting everything ready. And they did a great job with this, and it got them really started well. And the one other thing I would say is, every time they build a spacecraft like this, they build a backup. And if the first mission is successful, as they have actually always been, then the second one is sort of modified and repurposed. And so the backup to this, Chang'e 2, did much higher resolution global mapping and really got them set up for the landings that were to follow.
And Tanya, when I saw this, it was 2007, which kind of surprised me. It was that long ago. But then I was thinking about the late 2000s at the moon would have been jam-packed, not just, so China, Chandrayaan 1 was around this time, LRO, LCROSS, LADEE, the late 2000s, a lot happening at the moon, but you would have been rock deep in Mars at that time. do you remember paying at least paying attention to this stuff, or were you full team Mars back then?
I mean, I was full team Mars because it was while I was working in ops for Mars Reconnaissance Orbiter and getting ready for maybe some really early stuff with Curiosity, like some of the camera testing might have been that early on, because that was, I think, when I was working at Malin. 2007, that would have been during my master's. That was the year before I started working at Malin. So yeah, I would have been spending all my time actually crushing up gypsum to see if I could do different kind of spectral analyses to look for gypsum on Mars. But I didn't pay all that much attention to the moon. I didn't think it was very interesting.
Well, it turned out to be decent. All right, well, let's jump to the other one. This wasn't on my radar initially. It didn't come up in my initial search for this day in space, but I saw it on Twitter and kind of had to go with it. One, because I kind of want to hear if Phil has anything interesting on this, but either way, the Zond program, never mind Zond 8, which we're looking at right here. The Zond program was the Soviet counterpart, so I use that loosely, to the Apollo program. So Zond was essentially an off-brand Mega Bloks to Apollo's Lego, and I've always been kind of skeptical of narratives around Zond as a full-fledged Apollo competitor. It certainly existed, but the Soviet Union had a lot going on at the time, and Brezhnev wasn't Khrushchev in terms of interests. But nonetheless, we got up to 8 with this Zond program, which was vaguely aimed at putting humans on the moon. And this would have been in 1970. This is the last of these missions. And this is a human spacecraft with no humans in it going around the moon. And many of you might recognize this spacecraft because it looks remarkably like its descendant, which still operates today, the Soyuz spacecraft. But this thing, without any cosmonauts inside of it, went around the moon at about 1,000 kilometers above the surface of the moon, and then came back to Earth and crashed into the ocean. Zond 9 was planned. I don't know, Phil, if you know more about that, but it never took place, and it was actually to have 2 cosmonauts on it. But, I mean, the general story in this is usually that once Apollo 11 was successful, which would have been already about 6 to 8 months before this, the Soviets really gave up on Zond, but there probably was more to it than that.
Was more to it than that, Danny. Yes. So this was the, let me see, 5, 6, 7, 8. There were 4 missions like this that flew around the moon and back to Earth, testing, well, all the navigation and communications at lunar distances, but also testing the re-entry into Earth's atmosphere. And of those 4, none of them carried people. Of course, they were all test missions. But of the 4, only 1 of them had a survivable re-entry. The other three would have resulted in the loss of crew. They were not successful in that sense. And that's part of the reason why they didn't continue. But the other part of the reason is that they could never get their really giant booster, the equivalent of Saturn V, they could never get it to fly successfully. So without that big booster to make the mission possible, and with most of the re-entries of the Zonds not being survivable, they really were in a tough place, and it's not surprising that they gave it up at that point.
Yeah, and some nice imagery from this one you can see on the left there. And I did see a nicely new processed image on Twitter, but I couldn't re-find it, and I didn't want to grab it without permission. But there are some people working with these images and cleaning them up. They look really, really good. Not much. And I mean, Zond, like the Mars probes, like a few other things, with the exception of maybe Venera, some of the lost or less talked about things from the history of Soviet space exploration. Tanya, have you ever really come across much on Zond other than when we were writing the book on the moon landing? I might have brought it up.
Not really. I think everything I know about Zond, I learned from you in that process.
Yeah. All right. Well, we're going to stick with you, Tanya, because the next slide goes over to you. You had been busy in the last few weeks tweeting about, writing about one. Let me check this young gentleman's name, Wilhelm Shatner, who apparently went to outer space, is what I'm led to believe. Did you want to tell us about this strapping young lad's journey into the unknown? And I believe we have footage. Tanya.
This seems pretty accurate.
Yeah, this is exactly what happened. But yeah, the Shatner space launch.
Yeah, so this was probably all over the news wherever you happen to live in the world, but William Shatner, Captain Kirk, got to go to space for real aboard Blue Origin's New Shepard rocket. He flew with a few other people, including a former NASA person, one of the co-founders of Planet, the company that I work for, and I forget who the other person was. But all the attention pretty much was on Captain Kirk, of course. And when he came back to Earth, he stepped out of the capsule and then proceeded to give...
This is what happened.
This happened, you know, he maybe didn't come back on Earth. But he effused quite emotionally about what the experience was like for him. And it was really beautiful to watch, very unexpected. I honestly was not planning on paying a whole lot of attention to the launch, even though as a Trekkie, I thought it was kind of cool he was going into space. But hearing him speak about how much it impacted him just that few minutes into space, getting that, you know, overview effect, as we call it, was something really, really impactful. And I've seen some interviews with him since then where he's gone on to make some pleas that we, you know, actually start tackling the climate crisis. The government needs to get their act together. We need to make sure we have a world that's going to, you know, be habitable for our children and our grandchildren. And it's such a beautiful example of what astronauts often describe the overview effect to be. And so I hope that this experience is similar for more and more people as they get the chance to go to space. And hopefully, you know, someday it's not just going to be rich people that can afford a ticket to space, but, you know, maybe eventually we can do it as like vacation flights, or there'll be seats that are given away charitably, kind of like the Inspiration 4 launch where they went into orbit. So it was just really great to see all around that like this had such a big impact on someone that has such a big platform to be able to share that story.
Yeah.
Still really into this Zorn fight. Phil, did you see this episode when you were a youngin'?
No, I'm afraid not.
Did you watch
Star Trek? No, I don't remember this episode, no.
Did you watch Star Trek?
Some of it, but not all of it. So I don't remember this episode.
Yeah. It's all right. It's all right. What else we got in the news? Thank you, Tanya. Can just talk about a quick new paper that came out in the last month or so. New analysis of Hubble data, which you can actually, I think, maybe see over my shoulder, in Lego form at least. So in 2014 and 2016, respectively, Hubble detected that there were geysers shooting out of Jupiter's icy moon known as Europa. There you see them. These plumes, so to speak, were shooting out. And they were detected to have a water vapor inside of them. New analysis of data of Hubble looking at Europa finds that there might be water vapor mixed into the atmosphere of Europa that is actually, I guess you could call it, surviving or lasting for long periods of time throughout most of one of the hemispheres. So this has a few interesting potentials. Notably, water vapor is a powerful greenhouse gas, so it would provide a warming effect to an extent if it's there, which means that Europa's atmosphere could be slightly warmer than thought. Which would produce more likelihood for slush or other such liquids for life. So there's also the possibility, you know, that these moons like Europa, Enceladus, that are shells of ice covering a global ocean, that these might be periods or phases of their existence, whether or not you buy into the idea that Earth may have once been such an ice ball. Tanya, did you catch this news article or anything you've ever heard on Europa?
I hadn't actually heard this news, so this is pretty cool. I guess my question is for Phil, actually. I've always been like kind of skeptical of the Hubble Europa observations because they're not quite as direct as like the Enceladus observations of Cassini, for example. No. So like, how do you feel about the interpretation that there are plumes on Europa at all?
Well, you're right. Those the earlier Hubble observations that might have shown sort of venting at a particular point, little plumes, they're so close to the edge of detectability that it's really not it's not absolutely certain, I suppose. They're very close to the edge of what can be detected. But the newer observation that's just been reported seems to be stronger. That was it. There was evidence of water vapor emission over and, you know, like a substantial part of a hemisphere and longer lasting. I personally don't see that would have been enough to create a real atmosphere that could have a greenhouse effect or anything like that. I think it's probably too tenuous for that. It's still something that we should regard as an exosphere where the molecules might be bouncing around, but they're not interacting with each other very much and they leak away. But if the source is continuous, you could always have some there. It would just be a very tenuous thing. So I don't think that we should be thinking that the atmosphere is going to interfere with the landing of something on the surface, for instance. Yeah. But anyway, I think that the new observations are stronger and do encourage the belief that there could be some water vapor being emitted.
Well, that's exciting then.
Indeed. The icy, shelly planets or moons are always interesting. Mm-hmm. And I think that's all we have for in the news. So it's time to jump into the solar system rundown. Which this month is only two-thirds of Mars, or two-thirds focused on Mars, because we're actually going to talk about a new mission that just joined the robot family in the solar system. But as usual, we'll start with Perseverance, our intrepid Mars rover, on Mars since February of 2021. And Perseverance, again, as a quick reminder, is the rover on Mars that is collecting small samples of Martian material, stashing them in tubes and leaving them about Mars, as well as stashing a few with itself as well. It also has a cute little helicopter with it. So what's Perseverance been up to? I know even last month when we left, it was kind of the middle of conjecture and the essentially vacation for Mars robots. So not much has changed from this Mars Reconnaissance Orbiter image from early October. Perseverance wouldn't have moved much, but as of this week, it is moving again. So it is on the go. And Phil, where is it going?
Well, okay, so this shows it driving along the top of a ridge, and you could just get a sense that on the right-hand side, you're coming to the edge of the slope and it goes downwards. So they drove along like this, and then they found a place where they could get down, and they've gone down into a local depression and then up onto a ridge inside that depression. So yeah, they're driving around. They're coming into an area called Seta, which seems probably to be the oldest stuff that they will encounter during this mission. They've been driving around on what is probably lava flows covering the crater floor. And they've come down into this depression, which looks like it's cut down into areas that might be lake bed sediments underneath the lava, although it's not really clear yet that is the case. But they hope to get a look at these oldest rocks, especially if they are sediments, and sample them. So they drove in, they found a place, they actually cut into a rock a bit to see what it was like. And they decided that wasn't really quite where they wanted to sample, so they backed off. Then they've been out of communication for a couple of weeks as Mars went through superior conjunction, meaning it's behind the sun. And now they've moved to a new place where presumably they will hope to find these, the next place to sample and where they can maybe get a sample of what these sedimentary rocks look like. That's what they're doing right now. And I suppose I could just add that just in the last day, the little helicopter made an additional flight as well, just a short test flight, checking out its operations with a higher rotor speed than they were using before. But that just happened in the last
day. Yeah, that was just today.
Yeah.
Is that flight 16, 17?
No, it's 14.
14, okay. 14.
Yeah.
And we've probably talked about this a little bit, but I did want to, as I was going through kind of recent products coming out of the mission, both raw and the polished kind of communications products. I saw this one, which has probably been developed in the past, but was kind of re-upped, I suppose, by the communications team to maybe re-emphasize that, of course, Perseverance is one, or the scout for an eventual robot invasion. It's the first step in an attempt to bring Mars samples back to Earth. So we have Perseverance here. We have a proposed Fetch rover, which will go collect the samples that Perseverance has collected and put in caches. And then we have the return vehicle, the ascent vehicle, which is something particularly interesting because that what this vehicle represents is many things that have never been done on Mars. And really only ever been done on the moon. And then we would have the return spacecraft. So Tanya, I want to turn to you. You're well plugged into the communications aspect of these kinds of things. One, early ideas for the Fetch rover's name. Obviously some dog related names would be obvious, such as Fetch, Spot, that kind of thing. I was thinking you could do Finders and Keepers for the rover and the ascent vehicle. Or since the Fetch rover will be sneaking around and picking up grams of Martian soil, we could call it the Graham Burglar. Since it'll be collecting things, we could call it the Rock Mobster. Or what I think is the best is Tube Raider.
Oh, that right there, I think you've nailed it.
Yeah, I think we should call it Tube Raider. And in hindsight, we really should have called Perseverance Squirrely or Squirrel the Rover.
That would be better too.
I mean, Perseverance is good, but I'm surprised that didn't come up more often, given that it's hiding these things all around. So if you have any name ideas, throw them out. But also, how exciting / terrifying is the prospect of all these missions?
I mean, it's so many points of failure. It's a little terrifying. And like you said, it's a bunch of stuff that we've never done before. Like, we've never left something on Mars with the intent of sending another mission to go and get it. And then it has to take it back to the ascent vehicle. And then the ascent vehicle has to successfully get that cache up to the thing in orbit, and then that's got to send it back to Earth. Like, this is going to be really complex. And I mean, you know, these engineers are incredibly talented. If they can make something like a sky crane work, I imagine they can figure this all out as well. But it's still pretty nail-biting. So I hope it all goes okay.
Yeah, and it's kind of the correlation in this in space exploration is like the more exciting something is, the more risky or scary it is. Certainly the idea of getting samples off of the surface. I mean, Martian ascent, getting off the surface has long been one of the biggest challenges on paper. And we're yet to see it tried in practice. And it would be real interesting to see.
I hope we get a lot of camera angles, kind of like the Perseverance landing. Like maybe the Fetch rover will be able to take video of the ascent. And then hopefully there's some cameras, you know, on the ascent vehicle itself. We've been spoiled by, you know, all these cameras on things like SpaceX launches. And I think doing something like this, since we've never done it before, would be really incredible to have all of these different views from like a science and engineering standpoint. And of course, from a, you know, public engagement standpoint as well.
Yeah. And I mean, I'll have you know, Apollo 17 was successful in catching an ascent shot, which was very cool to see. And I would, I really hope we can pull it off with one of the two. I mean, maybe Percy will even still be running by then. Phil, any thoughts on this before we move on?
Well, the whole thing is going to be very complicated, as Tanya said. But I guess we do have something of a kind of model for it in the Chinese lunar sample return mission, Chang'e 5, just recently, where they scooped up the sample and then launched off the surface and then entirely, you know, robotically, they were able to hook up with an orbiting spacecraft and bring that back to Earth. This is different because it's so far away and, you know, a lot of things are different. But at least we have a kind of a model for how it will be done and know that it has been done successfully.
Yeah. And the hip cool word these days for that is autonomously. And yeah, a lot of this will be very intricate code running properly.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. All right. Yes, the obligatory helicopter picks, as Phil mentioned, just today, Ingenuity took flight 14. These are not from flight 14. These are from flight 13. I always try to find some, I don't want to say amateur. I know once in a news article, Phil was referred to as an amateur because he doesn't work at a space agency, I guess. But people who online, who may have other jobs, but process images also, I want to show off their work often. And this is from a gentleman named Thomas Appare, who's active on unmanned spaceflight and who has a Flickr site, like most of these people, who that shows off their work. And they're always, well, I don't want to speak for all of them, but most of them are very happy to have it used as long as you credit them. And I've said that before, but this is a very nice image processing, colorized and animated of several of the images from Ingenuity's 13th flight, which would have taken place early September before conjunction. And this is in that CETA region. It's looking at some outcrops in CETA. And yes, today it took another very short hop. This 13th one was a bit longer. The 14th today was very, very short. And it was essentially a test for the rotors to see if they could get a higher RPM for future flights that may need to go faster and higher. Tanya, is that outcrop we're right there that we're seeing, is that enough for to distract your geology brain? If you were on a walk, would you say, ooh, that one?
I'm actually more distracted by the nice little wind features in the foreground, like closer to the bottom of the frame than those particular rocks, but I might be biased there. Yeah. But I mean, the fact that one of the rocks is kind of, you know, tipped over, I might go and pick that up and see like, oh, did this break off of this outcrop here?
Yeah, right.
I'm really impressed with how amazing these images look, because this is just a commercial off-the-shelf camera that they put on the helicopter. This was not a science instrument. This was not designed to go to Mars like the, you know, multi-million dollar cameras that we actually have on the rover. So this is one of the most stunning products that I've seen, like, created from the Ingenuity images. So Thomas did a fantastic processing job here.
Mm-hmm.
I kind of already said it, but I want. How would you pronounce his last name?
I don't speak French, so.
I thought Appare. Appare. I thought there.
Oh, yeah, because
actually, absolutely. That's better than what I said. I said Appare, which is actually not. Yeah, Phil's right.
You work for the Canadian government. Aren't you supposed to be bilingual?
You know, I watched Caillou in French.
Okay.
I watched Babar growing up.
Okay. Good enough.
Sticking with Mars, I don't have any additional slides for this, but there was a news release put out recently. Mars is shaking. We already kind of knew that, but it's shaking a bit more than perhaps thought. Tanya, why is Mars shaking? Is it scared?
Well, we're not entirely sure. It could be some kind of geologic activity that's still happening deep within Mars. So maybe there's some magma that's sloshing around. It's not quite enough that any of the volcanoes have erupted any time in the last few tens of millions of years, but something is going on there. Or you could have like meteorite impacts that are causing seismic shaking. But since a lot of these Marsquakes are coming from similar regions, like a lot of them have been tracked back to an area called Cerberus Fossae, which is a very youthful volcanic region on Mars. The idea is that there could be some kind of latent activity beneath there. But the cool thing is that, InSight have been losing power for a little while because it's solar powered, as you can tell by these solar panels here. And so there was a lot of dust collecting on the panels, and they weren't really getting these nice dust cleaning events of the dust devils like we saw with like Spirit and Opportunity. So the engineers came up with this ingenious idea of basically sprinkling sand down toward the panels, which might seem counterintuitive. Why would you dump dirt on your panels to clean them off? But the thought was the wind might actually pick up some of the sand particles, and in the process, those would sort of entrain the dust and clean off the panels a little bit. And it actually worked. So the power levels went up a bit, and it was enough power to not have to turn off any of the instruments on board, because they were a little worried, especially moving toward conjunction, that they might have to shut down instruments to conserve power. So they were able to keep taking measurements, and they happened to catch in this time period this magnitude 4.2 Mars quake, which is the largest they've gotten on Mars so far. And that's pretty sizable, even for Earth. Like, if you were sitting in your house, you would feel that. So it's definitely telling us that Mars is a lot more active inside than we thought, which, you know, before InSight, we thought Mars was dead. So this is really, really exciting that we keep detecting these quakes. And InSight has been active for more than 1,000 sols now, 1,000 Martian days. And we're detecting more and more Mars quakes and more stronger Mars quakes. So it's been a wonderful result of having the mission go on for so long.
Here's a potentially stupid question that I never thought about. Does the Richter scale just translate, like we just use it for Mars? There's no Mars specific scale. It doesn't matter.
That's a good question. Someone on Twitter actually asked, I wish I could remember the answer in the thread, but they were asking, like, would the shaking feel different? Like, would it feel stronger because of the lower gravity if you were staying next to InSight? I was like, that's a really fantastic question. And someone answered it, and I can't remember what the answer was. But I'll dig through on Twitter, and if I can find the thread again, I'll post it in the comments on the Facebook and the YouTube link for people to find. But yeah, I don't know if you would, like, technically need to alter the scale somehow to deal with Mars versus Earth. That's a good question. Phil, do you know?
Well, I don't know very much about this, but my understanding was that the magnitude scale for earthquakes is measuring the amount of energy that is released or detected. I'm not sure which, but I don't think you'd have to modify that if you're on a different place. You're still detecting energy. So but I'm not sure.
No geophysicists on the call.
No. Maybe it's shaking because we keep hitting it with robots. Speaking of robots, the newest robot to join the space robot family is Lucy, which launched on October 16th, so just 9 days ago. And Lucy is a mission to explore asteroids, one in the main asteroid belt, and then 7 asteroids that are actually following Jupiter. And these are called Trojan asteroids, and we'll talk about Trojan asteroids in a second. So Lucy's, part of a few missions that are going to be coming up to look at asteroids. We've already had OSIRIS-REx. We've got Lucy now, and then Psyche is going to be coming up in the future to look at asteroids as well. I'll talk about the name Lucy. The spacecraft is named after fossil lady? That acted as an important piece of information in understanding the evolution of humanity or of humans. And it takes that name because the understanding or the expectation is that asteroids provide kind of a similar role as fossils on Earth, providing some insight into the history of evolution of our solar system. Asteroids are, either things that failed to become planets, or if we get really lucky, things that were starting to become planets and then got torn apart because Jupiter is an asshole. So that's kind of more what Psyche is going after. But we're going to talk a lot about asteroids from here on out. What did I have on this? Oh, yes, the Trojan asteroids. So around bodies in space, there are essentially what we can call gravity wells. I know some physicists don't like that term. You just saw there in the image that there are asteroids in front of Jupiter in its orbit and behind it. These are called Trojan asteroids, and they're stuck in these spots, which you can see right here, called Lagrange points, L4 and L5, or where those Jupiter Trojan asteroids are. And that's where Lucy is heading. Right now it's actually just heading for the sun, or at least for solar orbit. And then next year, this time, it'll zip past Earth again, get some gravity assist, a bit of a boost from us, and then make its way out to Jupiter. Phil, your thoughts on Lucy?
Oh, I think it's going to be exciting. One of the things that I love about space exploration is seeing new worlds for the first time, and we're going to see 8 of them with this mission. So it's going to be really exciting. There'll be things, categories of things we haven't seen before, these Trojan asteroids. So, I'm really looking forward to it.
Tanya, anything to add?
I don't think so. Oh, I guess one fun fact is that the solar panel design on Lucy is the same kind of design as on InSight.
Oh, yeah, that looks about right. That kind of looks like InSight.
Yeah, although they're much bigger, right?
A lot bigger, yeah. It needs a lot more power. And they had a little issue with one of the solar panels latching after launch. I haven't heard yet if they took care of that or not, but...
Not yet. No, okay. But they're working on it.
And first encounter, actually, I'll jump to the asteroids it's actually going to look at. And the first one is it Donald Johnson is the one in the main asteroid belt?
Yes, that's right.
Yeah. And yeah, that first encounter must be a few years from now.
Yeah, I forget the exact date, but a couple of years away, maybe. Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
I think the main belt asteroid is 2025. Yeah. And then it's like 2027, 2028 before they actually hit the Trojans.
Right.
Yeah, I had 26 in my head, so that sounds right. Yeah, these are the asteroids. The bigger ones are those Trojan asteroids that will be in Jupiter's orbit. Donald Johnson, if you're wondering, is the archaeologist who discovered the Lucy fossil.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Well,
one thing that picture doesn't show is that Eurybates has a little satellite which has been recently discovered. Mm-hmm. So that will be an additional target.
Yeah, they mentioned that in the video I was showing. That'll be interesting. That'll be the first asteroid satellite we've directly encountered.
Not quite. The asteroid Ida has a little satellite called Dactyl, which was imaged by the Galileo spacecraft.
Oh, I thought maybe. Oh, yeah, I guess Ceres doesn't have any moons.
No.
Does Vesta have a moon or like a moonlet?
No. No.
Okay. Tell how much we know about asteroids. That's
no, what but I hear. We're about to learn much more about asteroids because Phil's deep dive this month is all about asteroids.
All right.
Yeah, Phil, take it away.
Okay, so what I wanted to emphasize is that although we're going to look at lots of asteroids, they are not all the same. There's a lot of variation among them. And here's just three that are looking different. Let's just move on to the next slide here. I'll let Danny move the slides on. Here we go. Now, before anybody ever got to look at asteroids close up, the first small bodies, these little worlds, much smaller than planets, the first that we ever saw were the moons of Mars. There were two of them, Phobos and Deimos, and they look very different from each other. So Deimos is very smooth. It has a few craters on it, but it's really a smooth surface between the craters for the most part. And Phobos is much rougher, it's bigger, but it also has these long linear valleys cutting across the surface. Some people think they mark the traces of fractures inside Phobos. There are other possible explanations as well, including that they might be produced by rolling or skidding boulders thrown out of an impact crater. Possible interpretations. But anyway, the two moons look different. So then when you start thinking about how you might go and look at asteroids, you know, people were thinking, well, are asteroids going to look more like Phobos or more like Deimos? Or are they going to be a whole new category of things that are unlike either of these? And, you know, it wasn't really clear what they would look like. So let's go on to the next slide there. So first, they have lots of different compositions. When we look at these objects, some of them are made of silicate rocks. Some of them have more clay and carbon. So Mathilde has clay and carbon in its makeup as well as silicate rocks. Let's just move on to the next slide there. There's a huge range of sizes. Vesta is more than 500 kilometers across. Bennu is about 500 meters across. So in other words, there's about a thousand times difference in their sizes. Vesta is 1,000 times greater in diameter than Bennu. So this image is not to scale, right? So there's a huge variation in sizes, and that means a huge variation in their masses. So Vesta is heavy enough that it can hold on to a thick layer of debris more, and Bennu you would think that might not be so easy, but in fact, what's happened is that it seems to be all made of just a loose pile of debris. And some asteroids are only a tenth the size of Bennu. Yeah, so they would get another indication of that. There's a lot of difference in the structures of these things. Okay, let's move on again to the next one. There's a lot of variation too in the amount of volatile material like ices and other things that are easily evaporated inside these worlds. People used to say asteroids are made of rock and comets are made of ice, but this is totally out of date. Now we know that it's much more complicated than that. For one thing, a comet, which has some ice in it, when it comes closer to the sun, that evaporates and you see stuff kind of blowing off the comet and leaving a trail in space. That can eventually stop doing that because the ice gets all evaporated away. The thing dries up, if you like. So then it would be indistinguishable from an asteroid. There are other things that look like asteroids, but if they came a bit closer to the sun, they might start evaporating volatiles out. So it's not nearly so as straightforward as we used to think. And almost any asteroid, including these asteroids that Lucy will look at, they could very well have some ice in them. Or maybe on the surface even. So there'll be a lot of interesting things to look at there. Okay, let's move on there.
Actually, Phil, just on the asteroids versus comets, because so with the composition then being less of an issue, has there been discussion of, maybe it's orbital like activities, like comets are these big elliptical things coming in from the outer solar system, whereas asteroids are these kind of main solar system bodies that have these less crazy orbits?
Well, right. So most comets have probably come from further out and have been deflected in towards the inner solar system, which is where we see them. But even that isn't anything like as straightforward a distinction as you might think. Some main belt asteroids are now observed to have some patches of ice on them, for instance, but they're not, for the most part, evaporating away. But we do actually see some that were catalogued as asteroids, and then all of a sudden they put out a puff of something, and you have to say, okay, maybe it's a main belt comet instead. So it's just much more complicated than it used to be. And I think we can certainly expect that some of the Lucy asteroids will have evidence of ice on the surface, or even small amounts of outgassing that hadn't been detected from Earth.
So maybe we're entering a world, a post-asteroid and comet world, or there's just some sort of new word.
Mm-hmm. Okay, a quick word about the biggest asteroid of all, also called a dwarf planet, Ceres, which is nearly 1,000 kilometers across. It apparently has a kind of a briny ocean, salty water underneath the surface, and some of that leaks up to the surface or is excavated by craters. So we see spots of ice on the surface, or places where the ice has evaporated away but left clay and carbonates, kind of like limestone, on the surface. So there can be a lot of stuff going on these worlds. I don't know that we'll see anything like this among the Trojan asteroids, but we just don't know. Okay, let's move on again there. And also, they can have all sorts of unexpected surface processes. Itokawa at the top there, we have a kind of a false color version of it. Really, it would look gray if you were looking at it. But when you really exaggerate the colors so you can see them better, some parts of it are brownish and some parts look a little bit blue almost. As I do say, these are exaggerated colors. But that's a sign of whether the surface is old and exposed to the space environment for a long time, or quite young, produced by a recent impact or a rock being broken by an impact or something like that. And it's these younger areas that have just been recently exposed that tend to look slightly bluish in these exaggerated color images. And also on the same world, there are very rough areas and smooth areas, and the smooth areas are just made of finer particles. So some mechanism is separating out the finer particles and collecting them all together in certain areas. And we don't really understand how that's happening. So there's a lot to learn about what goes on the surface of an asteroid. Let's go on to the next one. Here's another asteroid called Eros, just little bits of Eros. Eros is sort of about is you know a substantially sized object, 30 kilometers long or so. It's got generally a rough cratered surface, but in certain areas you get these little patches where fine material again has somehow been drawn away from other areas and collected in depressions. They call them ponds on Eros. They're just little patches of very fine-grained material. So we don't really understand all the processes that are going on here. Let's move on to the next one again.
I'm curious, like I kind of almost want to throw this at Tanya, like from thinking about what could be causing surface processes, because certainly like subsurface processes, there could be melting or gravitational pull or something, or like tidal pressure or something like that, depending on where these asteroids are. But surface processes, we obviously we don't have wind in any way, shape or form. What does the geologist in you, Tanya, like something's pooling finer material in these potholes, so to speak. Like, where does your brain go with that?
I mean, it is a little weird without any wind, because that's what you would expect on a place like Mars, for example. You know, you tend to have storm systems that get, they just deposit a lot of crud inside depressions like craters, which is why a lot of the craters end up like filling up with little, you know, aeolian features here and there, wind features. I don't know what would cause them on something like an asteroid, unless there's just like some of them with enough of this stuff happening that like they happen to, I was gonna say gravitate toward the depressions, but I don't mean in the sense of like gravity. So I don't know. This is something that's really fascinating. Like the fact that we're seeing dynamism on the surface of asteroids. I don't think it's something anybody really expected. Or maybe they did, and I just didn't know because I am not privy to asteroid research literature.
Yeah, asteroids are more complicated than you think when you start looking at them. Just like everything else, really. Here's another asteroid that has maybe some grooves cutting through it, linear valleys. You can see several of them there. And there's quite a pattern of these running across the surface of this one. There's an asteroid called Lutetia, imaged by the Rosetta mission from the European Space Agency. So Phobos had some grooves like that. They're much better developed on Phobos, but maybe you know, some asteroids are going to show these. And indeed, yeah, here we do see some. Perhaps I tend to think this is because of fracturing in this solid body of the asteroid under a regolith surface. Anyway, let's have a look at the next one again. And here, this was really unexpected to me. The little asteroid Bennu, which the OSIRIS-REx spacecraft took samples of, and they're on the way back to Earth now. But when OSIRIS-REx arrived at this little asteroid, which is only about just over 500 meters across, tiny little thing, they started taking pictures. And some of the pictures showed a little spray of material, little particles kind of blowing off the surface and up into space. That was very unexpected, and it caused them to be very careful about how they dipped down onto the surface to collect those samples, because you don't want to be colliding with particles that are spraying off the surface like that. Now, other asteroids have been seen doing things like this in the main asteroid belt, detected by telescopes on the ground. You look up at the asteroid and suddenly you see that there's a little faint trail of stuff behind it, which has been blown off the surface like this. This is in no way really a comet. It's not blowing stuff off as a result of evaporating volatiles, as far as we know. But perhaps thermal effects, as a boulder heats up in the sun and then contracts again and heats up and contracts. Maybe sometimes it will crack and throw off a little puff of little particles along the way. So that might be what's happening there.
Potentially dumb question, Phil.
Oh, yeah.
A lot of our observations of these small, very dark bodies often rely on sunlight. Have we done much observation of these bodies when they're, I mean, maybe not entirely shaded, but the dark sides of them, like to get a good sense of just how much of this is solar driven?
I'm not sure what you would see on the dark side of an asteroid like that, the unilluminated side of it. But these puffs can be related to specific places. And There's a paper that describes, I think about a dozen or so places that they've detected where this is happening. And I, as far as I know, they're all happening in sunlight. But you know, potentially you could see stuff spreading out from somewhere on the unilluminated side if that was happening. But I don't know very much about the details of this.
So we have a question anyway, from the audience. I guess it ties a little bit back to the previous slide. Did the early solar system have clouds of dust that would have acted like wind causing erosion?
Well, it's a good question. I don't think we have to go back to the early solar system for this. So there's plenty of dust floating around in the solar system, you know, caused by impacts between asteroids and that sort of thing. So there are, and also dust particles blown off comets. So there are streams of dust along comet orbits and other stuff just floating around. So cosmic dust is there, but it, I don't know whether it would have an erosive effect like that. It might be too fine to have that kind of effect. But what it does tend to do is to hit surfaces like the moon or asteroid surfaces. Just a tiny dust particle doesn't have much energy, but if it's traveling at 30 kilometers a second, it's going to pack a punch, and it can sort of vaporize a little bit of surface material, and that, you know, these things can happen. So yeah, there is dust around, and we don't have to go back to the early solar system to find it. It can have an effect. Okay.
Awesome.
Okay, let's move on there. This is the same asteroid again, Bennu. There's a little patch of finer grain material surrounded by boulders, so we maybe was seeing a little bit of the concentration of finer material again. But also, when you look at the rocks, some of them are dark and some of them are bright, so they're made of different stuff. Some of them have smoother surfaces and some very rough. So they, you know, these are clearly different kinds of rocks. So even on this tiny little world, there are different kinds of surface material. I don't really know very much about the different compositions or anything like that. Clearly, asteroids are more complicated than we tend to give them credit for. Okay, let's move on again. All right. So, all these worlds are different. There's an amazing variety. And when Lucy goes out and looks at eight more of these worlds, we don't know what we're going to see because there's just so much variety among these little worlds.
Yeah, and I want to thank you for asking the question. That one question justifies doing this live despite all the additional stress. And also notice Phil is way nicer to audience questions than to my questions. It always makes me feel like I'm an idiot. Continuing along.
Now, would I say a thing like that, Danny? Would I say a thing?
So perfect timing because we don't have an overly complex game this month. In fact, it's quite simple. So it's Halloween, and it's time to play spooky games. But I also, this comes from the in space trope, which I imagine you're both familiar with. There's lots of examples of this in film and television, but the basic idea of the trope is that some sort of franchise or television show is growing stale, so they put it in space and it makes it exciting. Because writers, just like people in the real space sector, think that if it's a bad idea on Earth, but we put it in space, it might be a good idea all of a sudden. But bad ideas on Earth.
Jumping the cosmic shark, are we?
So this also comes from, I'm pretty confident neither of you qualify necessarily as cinephiles. You've both been very busy in your life doing things like science and research and contributing to our society in meaningful ways other than myself, just reading comic books and watching movies. However, I wanted to test both of yours knowledge of the in space trope. And given that it's Halloween week, I wanted to do this with classic horror movies. So classic horror franchises have notably gone to space. So the game is simple. I'm going to give you a horror franchise and you're going to tell me if it has gone to space or not. Does that sound clear?
Okay.
Okay.
Phil is the reigning champion. Would you like to go first or second?
I'll go second. Take that.
Okay, so when I design these games, I'm always thinking, what is Phil thinking? And part of that is not only will he go first or second, he'll almost always go second, so we can see what's in front of him. But I also have to figure out, where do I slot in the yeses versus the noes in these guessing games? Because Phil starts to think about what would I be thinking about. And it becomes
now you're just getting really meta.
Well, because I know this is what Phil does. At least it's what I think he does. Anyways. Okay, so Tanya, you're up first. Your first question is Friday the 13th franchise, which includes all of these movies, including The Final Chapter, A New Beginning, Jason Lives, The New Blood, Jason Takes Manhattan, Jason Goes to Hell, The Final Friday, Jason X, Freddy versus Jason, and the, of course, inevitable reboot. This is obviously the Jason franchise, the guy with the hockey mask. I am hoping you're familiar.
I'm familiar with the franchise. I did not realize there were this many movies. Obviously, Jason X is the SpaceX crossover movie that everybody has been clamoring for. I don't think this has ever been in space, though. Or I don't think there's been a movie from this set in space.
You were so close.
Ah, damn it.
Jason X literally is the space one.
Are you kidding?
Yes. So Friday the 13th has gone to space notoriously in Jason X. I'm not a big Friday the 13th guy, but I was a teenager around the time of Jason X. And am fully aware that Jason has gone to space.
I mean, so that means that I was also a teenager at the time of Jason X, and I did not know this. So
what are you talking about? I'm only 23. All right, so Tanya, zero so far. All right, Phil, you're up. You get the Leprechaun franchise, which includes Leprechaun, Leprechaun 2, Leprechaun 3, Leprechaun 4, Leprechaun in the Hood, that's a typo, Leprechaun Back to the Hood, Leprechaun Origins, and Leprechaun Returns. What say you, Phil?
Well, bearing in mind that I've never even heard of this so-called franchise here, I would probably start by saying your luck just ran out, Phil, because I don't know. So I'm going to say no, never space.
You're going to say, sorry, I didn't catch
never, that. Never
no,
space.
No, that is incorrect. Huh. I started off with two spaces because I'm trying to trick you.
Sneaky.
Leprechaun 4, I had to keep the subtitle out because it is called Leprechaun 4 in Space.
Ah.
And what's that, Tanya? You want to hear the full plot synopsis? You got it. In 2096, on a remote planet, the Leprechaun courts an alien princess named Zarina in a nefarious plot to become king of her home planet. The two agree to marry each other, with each secretly planning to kill the other after the wedding in order to enjoy the marriage benefits. So he would get her kingdom, she would get his pot of gold. It's not done. A platoon of space marines arrive on the planet to kill the Leprechaun for interfering with mining operations. So it's a space mining planet. Space Marine Private Lucky tries to steal the Leprechaun's gold, never a good idea, but gets killed by the Leprechaun's lightsaber. That's right. A grenade explodes and kills the Leprechaun. Gloating over the victory, one of the Marines urinates on the Leprechaun's body. Unbeknownst to the Marine, the Leprechaun's spirit travels up the urine stream into his penis, where his presence manifests as gonorrhea. The Marine returns to their ship, elsewhere on the ship, the Leprechaun violently emerges from Kowalski's penis after he is aroused during a sexual act. We'll keep it a kid's show. The Marines hunt the Leprechaun, who outsmarts them and kills the crew. So,
well, I said I'd never heard of this franchise, and now I'm going to say I wish I'd never heard of it.
All right, so you're both 0 for 2. And we've explored the great film legend that is Leprechaun 4. All right, Tanya. Halloween, which includes all of these, including two different, well, I guess only one of them is a reboot. This is Michael Myers, the guy in the white mask. Are you familiar?
Yeah.
Okay. Has Michael Myers gone to space?
I don't think so. No, sorry. Do you need a definitive?
No, I was reading the comments, and people are going to bed, which is fair. So you're saying no?
No, I don't think Michael Myers has ever been to space.
That is correct. Michael Myers has not been in space. All right, Tanya's up 1-0.
First time ever.
No, you've been in the lead before. All right, Phil, Poltergeist. I don't need to go over much. It's about a ghost.
Yes. I think I'll say no.
That is correct. No ghosts in space. All right, moving along. Tanya, Puppet Master. Bit of a deep cut. Big franchise. I was a fan as a kid. The gist of it, I don't need to read a full synopsis for you, is killer puppets. Have the killer puppets gone to space?
This seems like something that went to space. I don't know why.
That is false.
Ah, man.
Puppet Master has not gone to space. They've gone to World War II. They've done time travel, sort of. All right. Phil, Nightmare on Elm Street, which is Freddy, the guy with the claws and the striped shirt. Yes. Has Freddy gone to space?
I don't think so. No. I think I would say no. I don't think he'd be allowed to take those claws on the spacecraft.
That's correct. Freddy has not gone to space. He has fought Jason, and Jason's been to space, but Freddy's not right. To space.
So space is Jason.
Freddy in space would be really, really easy because Freddy travels through the dream world. So if an astronaut dreamt of Freddy, Freddy's in space. So they had an easy end.
I think you just wrote your next story.
There's some comments that they'd like to see Halloween in space. I agree, Michael Myers in space would be interesting. Tanya.
I don't think this has been in space.
Texas Chainsaw Massacre. You going with no?
No.
That is correct. Leatherface has not been in space. It's very, I mean, famously takes place in Tejas, not space.
Yeah. Although I've never actually seen any of these movies. I've heard of all of these franchises, but I don't think I've ever actually seen any of the movies in them.
The Leprechaun is like that Irish episode, the space ghost episode of Star Trek.
Oh, God. Just like that. That's terrible.
That's a good one.
All right, Phil. Amazing. Critters, which includes Critters, Critters 2, Critters 3, Critters 4, Critters Attack.
It's got comets in the background.
Yeah, like, that's right. And that tips me off that there's something spacey about this. So I'm going to say yes.
Yes, you're right. However, okay, so the in-space trope means that a portion of the film's main sequences take place in space, including the main characters. Right? Okay. So you can't just have a scene in space for it to count as an in-space film. So okay. Critters, the first one, starts with a scene in space because the critters are from space, but that doesn't count as an in space. However, Critters 4 takes place in space, so it is an in space.
All right.
So you must understand the rules of the trope. and that puts Phil up 3-2. I think there's only two left because Tanya went first. So Tanya, you need this to tie.
Oh, okay.
Hellraiser. This gentleman's name, informally, I believe, is Pinhead. I don't think that's his formal name. Seems like a bit of a slur, if you ask me. But has Hellraiser, Mr. Hellraiser, been to space?
I think I actually saw the first Hellraiser, like, covertly as a teenager or something like that. I don't think this has ever been in space.
Oh. Hellraiser 4, Bloodline, takes place in the future and in space. I don't know.
I feel like You said you've designed these for like how Phil is going to answer. So now I'm sure that you have just rigged all these against me. Like,
no, I haven't. I was trying to help you. I'll explain when we're done.
But I'm just that bad.
So Phil has already won. This is to rub salt in the wound. Child's Play, which is the Chucky franchise. Has Chucky been to space, Phil?
No.
That's correct. Chucky has not been to space. Phil wins 3-2.
I know absolutely nothing about any of this stuff, so that's amazing.
Yet you still win every month. So I had 4 in spaces and 6 not in spaces, and I had to decide how to break them up. And I put 2 up front and 2 near the very end to try and have a large block of not in space to throw you guys off. But I don't know. Phil still won. Yep. All right. Well, thank you everyone for joining. We really, really appreciate joining live so that you can ask questions and give us some kind of attention in the comments. And we're glad to see those peaked up towards the end. So that's awesome. Please share the link with friends and colleagues who you know are into space stuff and want to know what's going on. You can follow Tanya online via Twitter and Instagram. And are you on the TikTok with the kids?
I mean, I have a TikTok account, but I'm too lazy to like put on makeup and look nice. So I've only made 2 videos.
Phil, of course, has millions of followers on TikTok.
Yeah, except for all the ones who don't follow me, which is all of them, because I'm not on TikTok.
All right. Well, it's been grand. I want to thank everyone whose images we use, which I think this month was just Thomas Perry. We didn't have the curiosity jumping, so we didn't have Sean's. But yeah, we'll be back next month to talk more about space. So thank you, everyone. And that's goodbye for me.
Yeah. And if there's any topics you want to see us cover in the deep dives, definitely let us know in the comments. And we will definitely take that into account when we plan for future episodes.
Yeah. DM me on Twitter and I'll give you Phil's home address so you can knock on his door and tell him what to talk about.
Okay.
All right. Bye, everybody.
Bye. See you, everyone. Bye.